एमसीएस मेडिकल कॉलेज मैम, तमिलनाडु।
Great, great. So here you are seeing some vision therapy cases as well. Have you got your postings in orthoptics department? Yes.
Not yet started our internship, ma'am.
You are in internship, right? Right. So yes, if you get ma'am. To see some kind of good orthoptic evaluation patients or vision therapy patients, please share with us. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Some.
Sure. Okay. So I'll be discussing about orthoptic evaluation in details, but before that I would like to ask you some question as well. So do you know what is sensory fusion and motor fusion? Anyone have any idea about that? Sensory fusion and motor fusion, any idea about that? Yes. Any idea about sensory fusion and motor fusion? Anyone, please do answer. Any one of you? Anyone? Hello? Will you try? Yes. Please try. Yes. Please try.
Ma'am, when required areas of the retina are stimulated, so that is known as sensory fusion.
Right. And what is motor fusion?
So ma'am, motor fusion until our eyes make movements until the point of fixation falls on our fovea, and then I guess that is motor fusion.
Right. So basically sensory fusion is a phenomenon of normal fusion. So when there is a fixation point in front of us, okay, the rays of that light, rays from that object falls on my retina. So basically those rays of light falls on my corresponding retinal points and gives rise to a single and fused image. So these phenomena is basically your sensory fusion. So there is an object of interest in front of our eyes, okay, rays from that object of interest is falling on the corresponding retinal points on my of my retina, okay. So once the rays of light falls on the corresponding retinal points, it gives rise to a single mental impression. That's why we see that image to be clear and single. Okay. Motor fusion is something that actually assists the sensory fusion. So it is the ability of both eyes to maintain the sensory fusion through a range of vergence movements, basically. Okay. So suppose I cannot fuse those images. Okay, I cannot fuse the images. So what will, due to some problems, due to misalignment of my eyes, so by my vergence movements or my version movements, I'll be trying to fuse that object. Okay, because like I should not see any object to be double. It will create double vision or confusion, right? So I should be able to fuse that object. Is it clear? So what is a sensory fusion and what is motor fusion? Any doubt in that?
No, ma'am.
Okay, anyone, anything, any like to share anything else about sensory fusion, motor fusion? Okay, so basically your version and vergence movements, version movements are the conjugate movements, means when I'm looking to my right, looking to my left, up, down, dextroversion, levoversion, dextro elevation, levo depression. Okay, so dextro depression, levo depression, dextro elevation, levo elevation, all these are my version movements. So these are the conjugate movements. So when I'm looking my eyes to taking my eyes to the right, left, up, down, and diagonally I'm moving. Okay. So these movements occur simultaneously, and vergence is the disjugate movement, means the my eyes will move into the opposite direction. This is the convergence. So when my eyes will move in towards like this, this is the convergence or the positive fusional vergence, and this is the divergence when my eyes will move outside. Okay, so when my eyes are moving outside, this is called the negative fusional vergence. Okay, so when do you need to give any orthoptic like any vision therapy? If the patient is having any difficulty, in fusing those objects, okay? So when I cannot maintain my sensory fusion or motor fusion, I'm not able to maintain that, okay? Or I have some problem in my accommodation, I cannot see that objects, I cannot make it single, I cannot clear that image, I'm seeing some blurred images, okay? So that time I require to do an orthoptic evaluation, because that may be any problem in my vergence, versions or accommodations. Okay, basically the problem may be in my convergence, divergence and accommodations. Okay, so all of you know about this. These are called non-strabismic binocular vision disorders. So do you have any idea about non-strabismic binocular vision disorders? Yes. Non-strabismic binocular vision disorders, any idea do you have?
I'm so basically convergence insufficiency or divergence insufficiency.
Right.
Ill-sustained accommodation.
Right. Right.
So all these are included in non-strabismic binocular vision anomalies.
Correct. Correct. So basically, if I have difficulty in my convergence, I can have a convergence insufficiency. I can even have over convergence. If my eyes are over converging, so that is a convergence excess. Okay. I can have a divergence insufficiency, means when I'm looking at a distant object, my eyes are getting esophoric, means my eyes are turning inwards. My eyes are not correctly diverging. Okay. So that is a kind of divergence insufficiency. Okay. So in case of divergence insufficiency, what is happening? In case of divergence insufficiency, the distance esophoria will be more, right? So if the distance esophoria is more, then I can have a divergence insufficiency. Divergence excess, the distance, there will be high amount of exophoria, right? Then there is something called basic esophoria, basic exophoria. Basic esophoria means my esophoria, that means esophoria means when my eyes are turning inwards, okay? So amount of esophoria for distance and near, if it is same, that is called a basic esophoria. If the amount of exophoria for distance and near is the same, that is called a basic exophoria. Okay. So there may be a lot of problems. So these are my vergence problems, what I have discussed. Now accommodation problems, what are there? Accommodation insufficiency is there. Ill-sustained accommodation is there. Accommodation infacility is there. Okay. So accommodative spasm is there. So if the accommodative spasm rises to a certain level, it can give rise to pseudomyopia. So these are all cases basically we come across while we evaluate a patient in our clinic. Okay. So how a patient approaches to your clinic? What are the problems the patients face? What are the problems the patients face while they come for an orthoptic evaluation? What kind of problems they may face? Anyone?
Ma'am, many a times they come with a complaint of headache or eye strain.
Okay. Headache, eye strain, yes. The patient may have headache, eye strain. The patient may have blurring of vision. The patient may have doubling of vision after long hours of reading. Okay. Sometimes some children complain that I cannot concentrate on my studies. The parent actually scolds the child. Okay. So because the scolds the child that you are doing some kind of mischiefs. So, but that is not maybe the case. Okay, the patient may have some kind of convergence problem. Okay, so let us come through the problems one by one. Any questions, please do ask. You can unmute yourself and please do ask any questions. If you cannot follow anything, please do ask. Okay, so basically orthoptics is a systemic and step-by-step phenomena of evaluation of the efficacy of eye muscles during normal binocular eye movement to maintain binocular fusion. Okay, so what my, there are six extraocular muscles we all know, lateral, like my lateral rectus, my medial rectus, my superior rectus, my inferior rectus, my inferior oblique and my superior oblique, right? So there are these six extraocular muscles. So when these six extraocular muscles does not function properly, so that time we can have disruption of my normal binocular eye movement, right? Waiting room, anyone is there? Let me see. Okay. Right. So if there is some disruption of binocular, if there is some, if my eye muscles does not function properly, there is disruption of my normal binocular eye movements. Okay. Also, these six extraocular muscles make some yoke themselves, means they work in pairs. Okay. So when I'm looking to my right, my right eye lateral rectus and left eye medial rectus, these two muscles are working. Similarly, when I'm looking to my left, my left eye lateral rectus and right eye medial rectus are working. So these two muscles are pairing themselves, okay? So whichever gaze position when I'm looking, there are two muscle pairs which yoke themselves. So these are called yoke muscles, okay? Sometimes we have this problem of the yoke muscles working together properly. Sometimes we have some kind of muscle insufficiency, like the muscles will not work properly. So that time we may have disruption of normal binocular eye movements. There may be a convergence deficiency or a convergence excess or an accommodation deficiency or excess, okay? So these step-by-step evaluation, systemic step-by-step evaluation of this efficacy of the eye muscles during normal binocular eye movements, it is called the orthoptics. So this phenomena is called orthoptics. Is this clear to all of you? Is this concept clear to all of you? What is orthoptic evaluation? So do you have a basic, can you follow me? Will you, can you follow that, what I'm telling, talking about? So have you got some basic idea about orthoptic evaluation? Yes?
Yes, ma'am.
Right. So if there is some deficiency, we have to find out what is happening. Okay. So, coming to my next slide. Okay. So what are the basic questions to be answered? We all know, we have all have heard about computer vision syndrome, right? Computer vision syndrome, what is it about? Can anyone of you tell what is computer vision syndrome? Yes. Anyone, will you elaborate what is computer vision syndrome? Yes. Will you elaborate? Can anyone elaborate what is computer vision syndrome?
Ma'am, it means after using the computer for a long time, a patient may suffer the eye strain, headache, or double vision. So examiners always suggest that after using 20 minutes computer, patient always have to see the distant target at 20 feet for the 20 seconds.
Right. So, and also you should sit straight on the chair. Okay, the computer, you can see in this image over here, it should be at your eye level. It should not be too much above your eye level, so that you have to strain your neck like this. Okay, so it should be at your eye level. The chair should be straight. There should be some hand rest. You should be able to keep your hands. Okay, so you should be able to rest your hands. Okay, and you should always take a 20-20-20 like that. You should practice. So after each 20 minutes, you should give a break. Okay, so you look at a distance target for 20 seconds, blink, and then you look at a move to a near target. Okay, so these kinds of breaks you need to give. Okay, so basically, when a patient visits your clinic for the first time, you should, before doing an orthoptic evaluation, you should find out some basic questions. You should be able to answer some basic questions. Whether the patient is having binocular single vision, that is important. So if the patient is having binocular single vision, okay, then you should definitely, you can perform orthoptics. If the patient is having diplopia, okay, so you may have to evaluate in a different manner. You have to find out whether the patient is having a suppression and what is the ocular alignment of the patient and the status of accommodation of the patient you need to find out. Okay. So there may be many patients may complain of headache. Many patients may complain of headache. So headache basically may be related to your eyes, may be related to, may be neurological also. So all of us know what is the headache related to my eyes, what kind of headache we will have if the headache is related to my eyes. Yes.
Ma'am, it happens during uncorrected refractive error.
Yes, during uncorrected refractive error, we'll have it. Basically, we'll have a bitemporal headache, okay? The patient will complain of a bitemporal headache, okay? If the headache is only one-sided headache, okay? Or it is pinpointed to some region, okay? So that may be a migraine headache. That may be something else. If the headache is not like that, if it is bitemporal, and if the headache is increasing while reading, so suppose the patient will complain that when I'm reading the material for longer duration, I'm getting the bitemporal headache. Okay. So you should take a, first you need to take a detailed history of the headache. Whether the headache persists for few minutes or it continues for long hours, that you need to ask. You need to ask the patient, how does the headache get relieved? Okay. That is very important, because sometimes the patient takes some medicines for relieving the headache. Sometimes patient may use some balm or something to relieve the headache. Sometimes the patient may take rest. Okay, so after taking rest, the headache may get relieved. Sometimes the patient tells that if he takes a coffee, it actually relieves the headache. So we have to take the detailed history of headache. We need to ask whether the patient have a vomiting sensation during the headache. Okay, so if the patient is having a vomiting sensation during the headache, so that may be neurological, that may be related to migraine. Okay, so basically, if the headache is related to my eyes, it will be a bitemporal headache. It may be associated during reading time or any sort of near work. Okay, or if I am working in the computer for a long time, so I may get headache. It may increase while going out in the sun, associated with pain around eyebrows. So that is a sinusitis maybe. Okay. So if I feel difficulty at sunlight, if I have a pain around my eyebrows, it may be sinusitis, right? So sometimes if I have convergence insufficiency also, if I am getting light sensitive. So sometimes bright light may cause irritation and headache. Okay. So this time of onset, how it gets relieved, where actually the headache is happening. Okay. If it is concentrated to some area, that we need to find out. If it is back side of the head, that I have to need to find out. If it is increasing while bending down, if there is a vomiting sensation or a nausea, that may be a migraine headache. Okay, so we need to distinguish between ocular headache and non-ocular headache. That means the headache related to my eyes, okay, and I should distinguish it from the neurological part. Okay, is this clear to all of you? Am I clear to all of you? Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So we need to distinguish it. Okay. So there may be another thing I'll tell you. This is a unique feature of convergence insufficiency. There is an intermittent blurring of vision during reading, or a doubling of vision while reading. Means when the child is reading for longer hours, he cannot concentrate while reading. The letters are getting blurred. He is getting too much of eye strain while reading. Okay. At first, while he is reading, there is no problem while he is reading. But suppose he is reading for continuously for 1 or 2 hours. Continuously he is reading for 1 or 2 hours. So that time he is getting some kind of eye strain. There is a sudden blurring of vision. Letters are getting jumbled. Letters are getting blurred. Letters are getting double. Okay. Or if you are, if the child has gone to the school and after coming back from the school, the child is reading, so that he will find more difficulty. So this kind of intermittent blurring gets worsened after stressful work, and there is a associated headache with that. So this is the intermittent blurring of vision during reading. Also, the person will feel like closing one eye. So if I'm closing one eye of my eye, I feel relieved. Okay, so this happens. Why can this happen? This is a classic sign of like convergence insufficiency. So why can this happen? Can anyone have any explain this? Why can this happen? Why there is an intermittent blurring of vision during reading?
Yes, ma'am. After reading for a long time, our eyes becomes somehow exophoric. As a result, there is occurred disruption of fusion.
Right.
So patient gets blurring of vision, and then a patient again try to fuse their eyes, means try to fix it again, and so as a result there occur eye strain.
Okay. So all of you know there is something called fusional vergence reserve. Can anyone explain what is a fusional vergence reserve? Anyone explain fusional vergence reserve? Yes, anyone will try to explain fusional vergence reserve? Yes. What is fusional vergence? Any idea about that? What is fusional vergence? So basically, relative fusional vergence is a maximum vergence movement enabling a patient to see a comfortable, clear image. Okay. So there are two kinds of fusional vergences. One is my positive fusional vergence. One is my negative fusional vergence. So everything has a limit, right? Everything has a limit, right? So suppose I'm looking and fixating an object at near, okay? So I'm bringing it towards my eyes. I'm trying to focus the object and bring it towards my eyes. At one point of time, what is happening? I'm seeing a blurred vision, and after that, it will become double, right? Why it is happening? Because my convergence is breaking, my fusion is breaking at this point, right? So like my positive fusional vergence works while I'm reading a book, okay? So there is something called fusional vergence reserve, means there is some limit of positive fusional vergence that I can that I have, okay? So if that limit crosses, I cannot fuse, right? If I'm having if my positive fusional vergence is not up to the mark, then I might have some kind of convergence insufficiency, okay? So positive fusional vergence, how it can be tested? We test it by using that base in and base out prism bars. Have you seen horizontal prism bars? So let me show you. I hope so it is there. So horizontal prism bars, we can check the not having the image. Okay, so with the horizontal prism bars, we can basically by the step vergence test, okay, we can basically measure the positive fusional vergence and negative fusional vergence. Okay, so let me go back. Yes, so negative fusional vergence, basically, it measures the amount of the divergence of the patient's eyes to maintain binocular fusion in presence of a stimulus. Okay. And positive fusional vergence measures the amount of how much the patient's eyes converge to maintain fusion. So, if I am keeping a base out prism, okay, it can increase the vergence demand. It can increase my vergence demand. Okay, so I can measure with increasing the base out prism amount, I can basically measure the amount of positive fusional vergence we are having. Okay, so blur, break and recovery measure, we'll discuss this part later on. So just to have an idea of positive and negative fusional vergence, the positive fusional vergence is something is like this. It is keeping my eyes, helping my eyes to keep the object to be clear and single at near. So when I'm bringing some target towards my eyes, it is trying to maintain fusion for a longer duration. So when I'm converging or reading, basically my positive fusional vergence is working. Okay. And when I'm looking at distance, I need to diverge. Right, otherwise also I'll see it double, so that time my negative fusional vergence is working. So is this concept clear of positive fusional vergence and negative fusional vergence? Yes, is it clear to all of you?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Okay, so there may be an intermittent blurring of vision during work. There may be an intermittent diplopia. So if the condition is worsened, if my positive fusional vergence reserve exceeds, that limit exceeds, it may cause intermittent diplopia. Intermittent diplopia means sometimes the words are getting doubled. Okay. Sometimes it is single. Sometimes it is getting blurred also. Okay. So I may have a intermittent divergence field. So if there is a intermittent diplopia. Okay. So these are all the vergence problems what I have discussed. So if the patient is having any problem in their vergence, missing convergence, the patient may have this kind of difficulties. Okay. Some patients may complain that when I'm looking at a distance object, it is getting doubled. What is happening? See, when I'm looking at a distance object, my eyes are moving like this. So this is the negative fusional vergence. So my negative fusional vergence is also helping to keep that object to be clear and single. Okay. So these are the two images formed by the two eyes. So these will fuse to form a single image. So if there is any temporal retinal disparity or nasal retinal disparity, that time our positive and negative fusional vergence will work. If there is a binasal disparity, then my negative fusional vergence will work. If there is a temporal retinal disparity, so that time my positive fusional vergence will work and try to see that object to be clear and single. So my aim is to see any object to be clear and single. It should not, there should not be no diplopia, no confusion, and I should not get my eyes to be strained. So that is my positive fusional vergence and negative fusional vergence trying. Okay. So positive fusional vergence is trying to maintain fusion at near. Negative fusional vergence is trying to maintain fusion at distance. Is this clear to all of you? Yes. Yes, Lavanya, Kirtana, can you follow? I cannot hear from you all. Ma'am. Yes? Can you follow?
Ma'am.
Okay, okay. So others, all of you can follow, right? Okay. So, hope so this concept is clear. So for basically for convergence, the child may have difficulty in reading, may have intermittent diplopia, intermittent blurring of vision, getting eye strain while reading. Okay. So sometimes the parent may notice or some of the family members is noticing that one of the eye is going out. Okay. So if one of the eye is going outside, so there is a intermittent exotropia. Okay. So intermittent divergent squint may, the child may have. Okay. So these kind of conditions needs to be taken care of at the earliest. Okay. So these are the conditions very commonly found out, like convergence insufficiency cases are very commonly found out. Okay. Sometimes the child's parent may notice that the child is getting esophoric at times, means the eyes are turning inwards. Why can that happen? Why can esophoria happen at times? Anyone, can you explain? If you explain with the concept of negative fusional vergence, can you explain why esophoria is happening at times? Yes. So when my negative fusional vergence is, my negative fusional vergence reserve is breaking, right? That time my eyes is getting esophoric. Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes. When my negative fusional vergence reserve is getting affected, means I cannot diverge properly. When I'm looking at a distant object, I should diverge like this. My eyes should get diverged like this, right? So when I'm fixating at a distance object, if my eyes cannot diverge like this properly, so there is some kind of difficulty in my negative fusional vergence. So that means my negative fusional vergence reserve is not proper, right? So that is the reason the eye is getting esophoric. At that time, what is happening? There will be a double vision. Basically, a double vision is noticed. Sometimes we do not notice also. Sometimes we skip it also because sometimes there is a suppression also happening. So that needs to be taken care of immediately. Okay. So is it clear to all of you? Any questions? We'll end up this session, today's session here. I'll discuss about these other difficulties in the next day. So any questions do you have till this? Any questions do you have till this?